Let me welcome you all. Thank you very much for taking time and sharing your interest with us tonight. It is an absolute pleasure to have you all here tonight. I am Chris Ball, director of the Central European Institute here at Quinnipiac University. We have a very special guest tonight, direct from Poland, as they, I'm sort of half watching them correct the video here. Professor Balcerowicz is perhaps best known for taking control of Poland's economy in a very positive way. In the early 90s, end of the 80s, he was among the early people thinking about and implementing how to change Poland from a communist economy to a market-based economy. For those of you who don't realize it, the world didn't have experience transitioning an entire economy from nationally owned to a private market-based system. We had a few examples in the world, maybe some privatization in England, but the scale and scope of what was required as the Soviet Empire collapsed is just beyond imagination. Professor Balcerowicz formed the intellectual underpinnings and guidance of how that should be done correctly. He argued early on for quick and efficient and deep reform that was radical. He argued that it should be done in a way that gets past the pain and maximizes the opportunities from a free society as soon as possible. At the time, he was heavily criticized. We were not sure whether it was the right thing or not, and history has proven that it was indeed the correct thing to be doing. He served Poland as deputy prime minister, as finance minister, and as central bank chairman. And he has, I would say, served the Polish people for a lifetime in the freedom he's provided them. It's an honor to be here tonight. My job is just to make sure the PowerPoint is working, which it seems to be. And I'd like to take a moment to introduce the man who will introduce our speaker tonight, Alex Dorzhinski. He is currently our distinguished scholar and Polish chair at the Central European Institute. Alex is a scholar and writer on Poland, has written a wonderful top seller called The Peasant Prince on Kościuszko, recently released a documentary, and is joining us tonight to introduce Professor Balcerowicz. Thank you, Alex.
I just wanted to give a little context to the brilliance of our speaker tonight. To understand who he is and what he did, you need to first understand where he was from and the time period that he was from. He was born 2 years after World War II, at a time where Nazi Germany basically leveled Warsaw into a pile of bricks, the capital of Poland. And that pile of bricks was taken over by the Soviet Union and rebuilt, and they built a communist society, one based on fear and domination, and one based on basically just control by Stalin and by the Soviet Union. The generations that rebuilt Warsaw in that time, they had no chance. They had no chance that all of you students today here have to go and to learn and to really make something of your lives. I went to Poland in 1985 to see the country of my forefathers. And what I saw was a people in despair, people depressed, people standing in line. I stood in line waiting in a store, and I walked in and I said, I would like to buy some meat. And they said, no, this is the store that has no bread. The store that has no meat is across the street. And basically, it was a very strange place because there was nothing in the store shelves, yet somehow there was cheating and barter, and everybody was able to somehow manage and make their way through this strange economic system where people pretended to work and where the government pretended to pay them. And everybody was equally poor. And so when the wall fell, the Berlin Wall fell, and Eastern Europe became free, someone had to make sense of all of this mess. And someone had to create a system that would allow people to be rewarded for their work. And so the generation that came later, Generation X and the millennial generations, your generations that live in Poland have grown up with a totally different system, a system that rewards drive and rewards ideas and entrepreneurship and initiative. And that system was created by our speaker tonight, Professor Leszek Balcerowicz.
Well, first, thank you very much for inviting me to this beautiful, situated, and dynamic university. Second, thank you very much for these politely exaggerated introductions. Now, my topic is very broad, but I try to make it very short so that as much time as possible remains for the discussion. And the topic is about crisis and growth in different systems. But I would understand that you might have questions going beyond these broad topics, and I would be happy to try to respond them. Now, let us start with illustration. Now, this, what I'm going to say, is based on a book which was recently published by the World Bank. It is called Growth Puzzles. I have co-written it with my younger colleagues. And we have compared economic growth of countries which at some point in time were at the same per capita income. This is an illustration of Spain and Mexico. So you see that Spain and Mexico were the same per capita income, and then it diverged, and we investigated why. The main reason was that Mexico suffered more crises than Spain. Even if you disregard the recent crisis in Spain, Mexico is much poorer. And by the way, most crises are produced by bad policies. Now, there are some further illustrations which I would skip. And let me come to what I think is the most important problem in economics and policies, which is whether a country grows or does not grow. And it's especially important for poor countries who have to catch up. Because without catching up, meaning faster economic growth, then in already rich countries, practically no social problems can be solved. Certainly not poverty. So it's extremely important what contributes to economic growth and what hurts economic growth. Now, you can divide the factors which are responsible for the differences in the longer-term economic growth into what I systematic and crisis. What are systematic? Are those forces which are present for most of the time or all the time. And the first level, we know what is it? Innovations, which includes technology transfer in poorer countries. And by the way, 200 years ago, the differences between countries were much smaller than they are now. Because 200 years ago, 250 years ago, most countries did not enter the modern economic growth, which is based on innovations. And most differences in economic level of per capita income are due to the different dates of entry into modern economic growth, which is innovation-based. And this is still a fascinating subject for history. You might remember that Britain was the first country, then Western Europe. Eastern Europe was not that lucky. In Asia, it was only Japan, which started in the 70s of 19th century. So huge differences. Differences between China and Britain 300 years ago were very small compared to those who have been present in the 20th century. But whether a country grows based on innovation or not depends on the institutional system. And we know quite a lot what systems prevent innovations. All systems which are monopolized. Monopolies are hostile to innovations. And there are two kinds of monopolies. They may be in a private economy, in small countries which are isolated, it's enough for not to have competition and innovations. And secondly, socialism, or communism, if you will. It was monopolized without market competition. And with the passage of time, it turned out to be a huge failure. And there are very intermediate systems, which when we discussed. The more state intervention you have, the more regulations, usually the worse for the longer economic growth. But bad interventions tend to be popular, even in democracy, like in Greece. And then people pay the price. But I will leave aside these systematic forces, among which, as I said, innovations are the most important. And let me turn on the second kind of factors, which are usually called crises. I mean by crisis a deep breakdown in economic growth. So not just normal recession, not just minus one, maybe minus five, minus 10 decline in GDP, which is a measure of standard of living. Now, there is a cliché, which is absolutely false, that crises occur only under capitalism or market economy. And this is very popular cliché under capitalism, too. People like to blame capitalism for the problems caused by state intervention. But let us first skip it, okay. Now, if you look at the data, then you see that the worst crisis happened under non-market systems. Non-markets, but if you have a non-market system, you have a heavy concentration of political power. You don't have checks and balances. And whenever you have a heavy concentration of political power, you may from time to time have psychopaths as rulers, or people who are totally irresponsible, and they are not constrained, because they're absolute rulers. So they can do everything what they like to do. And we have examples. This is what has happened under Mao Zedong. He had some crazy ideas how to accelerate economic growth of China. And this has cost the lives of 50 million people and economic stagnation. You have these breakdowns in economic growth, but also there were people who were killed. Stalin, or Red Khmer Rouge, who murdered one-third of the population, and of course it was better educated. At the same time, it was also economic disaster. There are some milder version of autocrats which are not constrained institutionally, like Mugabe in Africa, or people who are just irresponsible, like Ceaușescu in Romania, Gierek in Poland. They were not psychopaths, they were irresponsible. And this cost countries quite a lot. So the main conclusion is rule of law, limited government, extremely important to avoid catastrophes which are produced by bad rulers who are not constrained. Do not bash the markets. Look at the concentration of power. And if it is excessive, try to limit it, if you can. And an extreme dictatorship, you can't, because you are killed, like in North Korea. Then you have to hope that there would be a bad luck, good luck, or bad luck to the dictator. But if there's a process of accumulation of political power, be very watchful. So these are non-market systems, but also there are systems which are called quasi-socialism, meaning like most Arab countries. This is quasi-socialism in a sense that state sector accounts for most of the economy. There is a bit wider margin for private economy, but state sector dominates. And remember, state sector, it's a political sector. Even in countries like in the US, I am not saying it's dominated by the state, but you have enclaves of socialism. An enclave of socialism is a politicized part of the economy. Like Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. They still exist. They are still supported. Why? Because it pays to the politician to have such politicized tools. And it takes a lot of mobilization in the society to push the politicians to give up these tools. Otherwise, it would not happen. So if one wants to have better policies in democracy, one has to mobilize. Because other people mobilize for bad policies. So there are examples that in quasi-socialist countries, when there is still a dominance of political power, there are instances of very bad policies. For example, Saudi Arabia, which is quasi-socialism, because most is state-owned. They own the main ruler is not called first secretary. It is called a king. But it doesn't, in Iran, the main ruler is not called first secretary, it's called Ayatollah. But the names, differences in name do not matter. The substance is that you have a heavy concentration of political power, which is very risky to the societies. So we have instances of bad policies in Saudi Arabia. Under socialists, we have a joke. What would happen if socialists was introduced in Sahara Desert? There would be shortage of sand. So something of that happens in Saudi Arabia. They run huge budget deficit. That would be very interesting if they go bankrupt. Now, you know, if you look around the world, communist or socialism remains where? In North Korea and in Cuba. And everywhere it was a disaster. Now, a quasi-socialist is not a good example either. So what do you have, if you want to be realistic, not utopian? You have different kinds of capitalism. By definition, an economy based on private ownership. But there are differences among capitalists, and the irony is that the best model is the most attacked. This is the free market model, which does not mean anarchy. It means that economy is based on general rules. And the scope of very detailed intervention, which is usually the result of lobbying, is limited. And this is under attack constantly. Usually it is like that bad results of state intervention, like the recent financial crisis, are blamed on free markets. You have large groups in society which like to do that. In US, most of Hollywood. Yes, free markets, corporations are villains. Most of the politicians, because they have to blame somebody, they cannot blame each other. So they blame the markets for the errors they committed, including the US. So one of the worst examples is crony capitalism. It's much worse than free market capitalism, which provides level playing field. In under crony capitalism, you have two kinds of entrepreneurs, politically connected and the others, like under Putin, Russia. And politically connected have a better protection than the others, so there is no competition, and politically connected can finish off other entrepreneurs. So you have very interesting crony capitalist takeovers by the use of KGB or prosecutors. And this is, of course, unjust and very inefficient sort of capitalism, which is sometimes confused with free market capitalism. Now, but let me come to my main topic. Crisis under the market systems. And this is a sort of anatomy. First of all, you have fiscal crisis, like in Greece. Now, fiscal crisis can be hardly blamed on free markets, because fiscal crisis result from excessive spending. Because too many voters think or pretend to think that politicians are Santa Claus. They are sometimes, I don't know, I believed in Santa Claus when I was 3 years old. But the grown-ups believe in Santa Claus, and they pretend to believe, of course, because the rationale is like that. I will push the politicians to spend more. I will get it, but other people would pay. So this is a cynical calculation in most cases. And once you got on this path, it's very difficult to stop. Sometimes it is only the crisis. which from time to time stops bad policies. So fiscal crisis cannot be logically blamed on markets. What about other crises? You have what I called enclaves of socialism. These are those parts of the economy which are politicized. As I mentioned, in the US you have Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, which were political tools of subsidizing credit to those who should not get credit because they were too risky. This was instead of paying them from the budget. Then, Spain is very interesting, because in Spain you had two kinds of banks, normal, say Santander, and so-called cajas. Cajas in Spanish means cash. These were banks which were politicized at the regional level. And whenever politicians control the banks, they tend to distort the allocation of credit. What do they finance? Something which is politically attractive, but usually does not make economic sense. So in the case of Cajas in Spain, they finance aquaparks. Aquaparks, they finance airports in towns which were connected by speedy train, and then they went bankrupt. A similar story occurred in Germany, which have also regionally politicized bank. And we have many, many examples. So one should keep politicians away from the banks as controllers and owners, because they would distort. Not because they are bad. They are on average not worse than the voters, but because they have different incentives. They want to avoid unpopular decisions and to introduce popular things, to be re-elected. So one has to look at enclaves of socialists under capitalism, and they still remain, except for the cajas which collapsed. Then, you know, why countries suffer the bust, a crisis, a deep recession? Because they allowed the boom to develop. If you want to avoid the bust, avoid the booms. You know, accelerated growth of spending, financed by accelerated growth of credit. And the most dangerous is mortgage credit in consequences. So what lies behind the booms? So accelerated growth of credit. The cliché is free markets. That free markets are inherently unstable. The truth is, which is based on empirical research, that behind these booms you have various combinations of bad interventions or interventions which aimed at popularity of politicians. In the US, keeping interest rates at a very low level until the boom was one of the reasons. But there were some regulations which pushed the banks to extend credit to poorer households, which were behind, as you know, behind the subprime credit. Politicians like to offer subsidies to mortgage credit because it's popular. But they make credits artificially cheap, and it tends to grow. There are some tax regulations which prefer or favor increases in debt relative to equity. And you have some 10 or more wrong regulations. Some 50 years ago, central bankers and politicians in the West started to bail out big banks because they thought it would be politically too expensive to let them go, bust. So when they started, they distorted expectations in the financial markets because creditors came to the correct conclusions that politicians and central bankers would not let big banks to go down. As a result, they offered cheaper credit to the banks, and big banks became even bigger. So these behemoths in the financial sector are not the product of free markets. They are the product of politically distorted financial markets. Okay, there is some more. So remember that if you want to have facts and not cliché, that one has to look at various combinations of interventions which may be politically popular. And if one wants to reduce risks of further financial crisis, one has to do something about the these interventions. I can only mention, if you like to, we can discuss it later, that the response, monetary response to the last crisis creates the probability of another crisis, which is a very low interest rate and created lots of money to stimulate the economy, which in fact meant stimulating asset bubbles, driving asset prices to very high level. But central bankers are regarded as magicians by the financial markets, which like liquidity, and by financial media, and popular media too, most of them. Okay, so to conclude, first remember that the most serious crisis happened because of excessive concentration of political power and not because of free markets. This is empirical. This is not doctrine. Second, even under capitalism, if you dig deeper, you see the hand of politicians and bureaucrats behind the causes of the booms, which tend to go into the bust. So the reforms we are aiming at reducing the risk of future crisis have to do something about the possibility of such interventions. Now, the last point, and then I stopped, as I promised. Let me say why boom and bust should be avoided. Because at least some of them are very costly to the society. It's not only the question of anxieties, increases unemployment. Some of these crises have lasting consequences. So the growth may slow down for a couple of years, and sometimes it does not recover very quickly. Whether how costly are the crises depends to some extent on the policies which are pursued after boom goes into the bust. And there is a huge debate on this topic, which I can only mention here. Now again, the mainstream conclusion is that if you have boom and bust, you would have to try to stimulate the economy to avoid excessive decline in spending. And many countries have gone into this route. It is very popular. But if you compare countries which have suffered boom and then bust, and you look at their policies after boom went into the bust, then you see that in many countries, an attempt to stimulate the economy, especially fiscal, has prolonged the problems. Because if your debt to GDP is already very high, you do not have further room for stimulation. Then, in such a situation, it is very painful, but better to make fiscal adjustments. And the best is to reduce spending in order to reduce the budget deficit. And this is, again, not doctrinaire, it is empirical. When we compare countries across the European Union, when we compare those who suffered boom and then the bust, we see that countries which have bitten the bullet, who introduced quickly the necessary fiscal consolidation, have recovered much more quickly than those who delayed because they were subsidized. And the main example is Greece. Greece has suffered not because it did not get many credits, it got lots of, but because it delayed the necessary reforms. And then the cumulative growth was around 25% of GDP, which is catastrophe. Okay, and the second point I would like to make and to repeat that, and this is my final point, that the main central banks, starting with Fed, reacted to boom and then bust which injected a lot of liquidity, meaning funds, and probably this was correct given the initial situation. But the problem has been with the further policies, which consisted in keeping low interest rates, very low level, and creating lots of money with the expectations that this money would stimulate the real economy. Now, this was falsified by what has happened. These expectations were falsified, and the economic growth is rather weak, including the US, compared to the previous episodes of recovery, while there has been a problem of growing asset prices, and there is a question, what would be the exit? And nobody knows for sure how all this story will end with this massive amount of money. So, the conclusion would be, the policy conclusion would be, do not trust the central bankers who expand their competences. Because the initial responsibility of central banks, and the one for which they deserve to be independent from the politicians, is to keep low inflation without disregarding financial imbalances. But in fact, they have taken responsibility for fiscal policy by providing cheap money to the governments. And when the governments who need to reform get a lot of cheap money, what do? On the whole, delay reforms. Because cheap money provides a more pleasant option. Now, let me stop for that. I don't want you to believe that there is no hope. There is hope in much more active people. As I probably said, politicians should not be left to themselves, neither central bankers. You know, let me, when I look at what prevails in the West, including Poland, Central Europe, people defend civil liberties, and rightly so. They defend freedom of speech, they defend freedom of association, of the media, etc. That's very important. What do they do not defend? Or do not defend enough economic freedom. Meaning a wide range of property rights which are well protected against excessive intervention and intrusion of the politicians. And it is a paradox. One can, of course, understand why it is, but it's a paradox because economic freedom belongs to human rights. It is fundamental. That's the first point. And the second point, we know from experience that whenever economic freedom shrinks, people pay a very heavy price. And the heaviest price was paid in the case where economic freedom was eliminated. This is communism. Extremely heavy price. But also in the Western countries, when there's excessive regulation, excessive spending, after a while, people pay a price. What is the price? Increased unemployment? Fiscal problems, a much slower growth. So the main conclusion I would like to leave it, do not leave economic freedom to the politicians and bureaucrats. Do not leave economic freedom to collectivist think tanks. Do not leave it to Hollywood. Organize in defense of economic freedom, because it's fundamentally important. Thank you very much.
Questions.
Yes.
We'll allow questions. Unfortunately, Professor, the microphone is not mobile.
Hello.
So if you have questions, please come over here. And if you cannot get out of your seat, then you're going to have to speak extremely loudly. Okay? But please.
We cannot share this.
No, we cannot share this.
Professor, I have a question. I understand that you do not like government intervention. However, where is the line? The government has to take care of certain things. For example, right now in America, there's a crisis of infrastructure. There are bridges that are collapsing. There are roads that are crumbling. And so something needs to be done about fixing the infrastructure. So where is the line in government intervention where it becomes unhealthy for government to intervene too much?
That's a very good question, but you should start with a question, why it is the government which has to finance infrastructure? Why shouldn't it be private sector? And the private sector is not doing, what prevents the private sector from doing it? It is not an economic law which says only the government can finance infrastructure. In the history of the United States, it was a private sector supported to some extent by the government which created infrastructure. So in many cases, private sector cannot function because it's prevented by the government. And there are many examples. I give you one from Poland. If tenants are protected so that you can evict them, even if you destroy the apartment, no private investor would finance construction of private apartments because this would be crazy. He would lose his money. So there is but people still need apartments. Private sector is prevented by a certain state intervention. People would demand apartments. Who fills in the void? The government. But why? Because the government blocked the private sector. If you increase minimum wage, which is very fashionable, pretending you help the people, then people don't get jobs. By the way, if you want to make immigrants unemployed, you increase minimum wage, and they're unemployed. Then the government steps in and helps unemployed. But who created unemployed in the first place? If you introduce rent controls, which is very popular, then it does not pay very much to build private apartments. Again, the government steps in. And there are hundreds of cases, hundreds of such interventions which block the private sector. And then there is a call for state intervention. I am not saying everything, but one should distinguish some basic function of the government, such which cannot be well substituted by the private sector, for activities which can be, which are not necessary. For example, we usually rightly assume that law and order, protecting people against physical aggression from other people, being from abroad, and we call it national defense, or from ordinary criminals, is best done by the government. But even this is not based on a monopoly, because you have lots of private guards. National defense is rightly considered as a basic function of the government, but even in this case, we have lots of private firms which are active because there's a lot of capital. You know, people who leave their army, they have precious skills. And functions which can mostly were best performed by the government are limited. So if the government does much more, it is not because it does it best, but because the previous state intervention has prevented the private sector to operate. There is a massive research which shows the damage which has been done. Social damage, unemployment, lack of apartments, which is being done by various regulations. For example, if you protect the people against dismissal, each individual would like to be totally protected. It is human nature. But if you protect too much, what happens? Private employers do not employ, or they are very risky. They think, I'd better do not employ. This was the case of Greece, of Spain, etc. So you have lower employment, more unemployment. But it may be even worse, because if politicians are afraid of lowering the level of protection, then they create a sort of a dual labor market. They leave already employed people with their privileges. These are insiders. But the new people do not have these privileges, so they have no contracts. They can be dismissed from one day to another. Now, if there is a recession, who is dismissed? not insiders, but outsiders. And the outsiders are young people. And they suffer. And then you have an explosion of unemployment, as it happened in Greece or in Spain. And many naive people blame it, put the blame on markets. But it is a result of a previous state intervention. The problem is that many people, it's sometimes pretty difficult to grasp this. It's not extremely difficult, but pretty difficult. This is why it's very important that in every society there are think tanks which communicate the cost to the public. Some of these policies, as I said, are very good for elections, but very bad after elections. Very good, you mobilize people to vote, you promise them more protection or more spending, etc. And then there are two choices after elections. This is the better one, you cheat, as a politician. The worse one, you fulfill your promises. So basically, let me turn to my main thought. Even in democracy, you can have bad policies unless you mobilize for better policies. Yes, please.
All right, so what do you think about private entities being able to compete with the government for public services? And also along that vein, what do you think of the rise of PMCs?
Could you repeat the first? I'm not quite sure what is the first question about.
So I was saying, what do you think of private entities being able to...
Private what? Because I... Entities, yes.
Being able to compete with government to provide basic public services.
Are you referring to the situation whereby you would have public financing on the demand side, financing side, by various entities which would compete for government money, like education vouchers? This is the case? Well, there's some experience for less developed countries. And to my knowledge, the experience is positive. But why not in the US? Because it's being blocked by the trade unions, teacher state unions. So you have less innovations than in some developing countries on that. But the basic idea is correct. If you want to continue spending public money, okay, but at least try to have some competition in education services, in health services, etc. But just a second, for competition to operate, you have to have a choice, but something else. Mainly those, say, hospitals or schools which attract more money should be able to grow and increase their salaries. But those who are not attracting should be reduced. And finally, they should face the danger or the risk of insolvency. Without the prospect of insolvency, there is no competition. Please.
I like your term of crony capitalism. Here in Connecticut, we have a state government who's paying Jackson Labs, which is a biomedical research institute, $1 million per job that they bring to the state. And they're also negotiating with General Electric, which is threatening to leave the state of Connecticut because of the adverse tax environment. And I'm sure Governor Malloy is in private discussions with General Electric, a top 10 company, to try to provide benefits for them to stay in Connecticut. So my question to you is, what do you think of the state government paying money to private companies to keep jobs here or to lure jobs here?
Well, I would not pretend I am an expert of every problem here. This would be not proper. I can only say that United States have a long tradition, 19th century, of clientelism and corruption, which was reduced in the end of 19th century, but probably not completely finished. And even if developed economies, citizens have to watch, especially the public sector. So institutes, I just have a pleasure to make a talk to Yankee Institute in Harvard, I think. This sort of institute, which is monitoring the officials and politicians, are very important. I would not comment in detail because it would be improper. But let me comment on principles.
Pleasure to meet you. I had a couple of questions in terms of the economics behind your plan. With China, you had the five-year plan in the 1950s, and then in Poland, you had your plan, which was a shock therapy kind of thing in terms of jumpstarting the economy. Whereas in the initial years, and it's based on your graphs, they had slow growth, but then eventually it was a long-term plan, so it led to immense growth. But with those successes, there were also some failures, such as with Russia in the 90s, they tried something very similar. And with that, my question to you is, with Russia, when they began to privatize some of the economy, it led to what we have now with Russia, which are oligarchs in terms of the richer, or I should say, income inequality in Russia, that led to very rich people owning, you know, making these oligarchs, and which is why it was a failure with Russia. How was that any different with you seeing that in regards to Poland? And how would you see, how would you say is that a change with modern day economics in terms of how fast the economy has been growing or falling, and also the rapid income inequality between people?
Well, these are very knowledgeable questions. Congratulations. You have to know what are the differences in initial conditions and during the implementation of the policy. First of all, between China and Central Europe. China started its market reforms in the late 70s, after the disastrous years of Mao Zedong. At that time, China was a poor country, much poorer than later Central and Eastern Europe. As a poor country, it was dominated by agriculture. And agriculture was organized in a nonsensical communes, big communes, when there were no incentives to work because everybody was given the same wage. This agriculture, however, was very easy to privatize. So the first steps by Chinese authorities was to divide these nonsensical communes into plots and giving peasants not full property rights, but longer term lease. And they started to work like crazy. This was a huge boost to the largest sector of the economy, which could not be produced in Russia or in Poland. Why? Because Russia was much more highly developed, better developed, and agriculture accounted for much smaller part of the economy and was highly complex. So this was the difference in initial conditions, which largely explains differences in economic growth in Russia under 91 and in China in the late 70s. This was not an only difference. In other words, was that in Poland and in Russia, socialism or communism ended with hyperinflation, but not in China. The third difference is that there have been many wealthy Chinese, Taiwan, Singapore, Hong Kong, who were ready to invest. There were not that many wealthy Russians. So this was not available to that. And finally, China was much poorer at the start, and poorer countries with proper policy tend to grow much faster. Okay, so I think these differences, logic explain differences in economic growth in China versus Russia. Now, when you compare Poland and Russia, the Russian reformers were my friends, and they were coming to Poland because they started 2 years later than Poland. And I think their approach was correct one. So, trying to reform fast and to stabilize fast, but they face much more difficult political situation. They have much less time. They face much more opposition in Russia. And they face some dilemmas which were not present in the West and not present in Poland. And the biggest dilemma concerned privatization, you mentioned. And this was a political dilemma, I think. I don't remember, probably 94, 95, there was a risk that communists would return to power via free elections. Because then President Yeltsin, the Russian president, was weakened. His popularity ratings were at 4 or 5%. And that was a very grave danger. And there was no money for a good campaign. Then so-called oligarchs, which originated much earlier under Gorbachev, offered money in exchange, loans in exchange for stocks. And the risk they were running were that if communists won, they would lose their loans. So they made a bet. These loans financed Yeltsin campaign. Yeltsin won. Communists did not return to power. But these oligarchs became even richer. It's very easy to condemn that when you do not know what could happen. So I am not condemning that because it's too easy. But thank you very much for your very good questions.
Hi, I'm Luciano Roschi, professor of economics at Sacred Heart University. I'll do a short preamble before I ask you a question. When I teach international economics, I always say to my students, yes, you can make a change in the world. And I frequently cite an example of Leszek Balcerowicz, who has the prerequisites for making a change. And this
I must add, he knows me very well. He's a friend of mine.
And a very good track record. You just need a solid knowledge, a commendable courage, that's Balcerowicz, and a strong belief in moving forward rather than embracing stagnation. I've had the privilege of knowing Leszek for many years, and in serving on his advisory council. But Leszek, considering your drive to move forward, what is your outlook for deepening of the European Union, taking into consideration the most recent steps backward? You know what I'm talking about. For deepening the European Monetary Union, for engaging Poland into the European integration a bit more, political cooperation. Are you optimistic about it?
I never discuss my mood. This is a private matter. Especially, are you afraid, etc., etc. One has to mobilize the people. If something is very important, you cannot prove it is impossible. So assume it is possible. And then try to mobilize the people. So now, let me tell you about Eurozone. Eurozone crisis does not mean there's a crisis of euro as a currency, because euro is quite stable. The main problems in the Eurozone are problems in some countries, which were created by bad policies. Greece, obviously, very bad populist policies. If there is a danger to the Eurozone, it is that there would be a danger that France and Italy would not reform enough, because they are growing very slowly. And people know why, economists know why. Overregulation, excessive fiscal spending, etc. President Hollande, after 2 years' delay, is trying to speed up reforms. Prime Minister Renzi is trying to do that, and let them wish success. Because this is the key to France and Italy, but it's also the key to the stability of the Eurozone. This is the first point. The second point is that European Union in a foreseeable future cannot be like United States, meaning a federal state. Why? Because what does it mean nowadays, a federal state? It means a large common budget. Even in the US, the federal budget is what, at least 50% of the total fiscal spending. And Europe common budget is 1%. And I am not saying it's bad. I'm saying it would be unrealistic to expect that it could be increased. Why not? Because for having a larger common budget, you need a feeling that you belong to one nation, more cohesion. And this cannot be produced very quickly, unless you have a common enemy. Perhaps common enemy helps. But it's better not to have a very strong common enemy. So it's unrealistic to expect there would be a large common budget, cross-European transfers, and this is in my mind not necessary for solving problems of Greece or some other countries. Better policies, better environment for private sector is the key. Cannot be substituted by handouts. Then a federal state would mean common army. But for that you need also a cohesion, and besides we have NATO. So what else? If it makes sense, some harmonization or mutual recognition, and certainly completing the single market, I think it's very important. Plus one thing, which may sound paradoxical, but to my knowledge, in the United States, say when Illinois or California run into fiscal trouble, federal government does not bail a state out. There may be some hidden increased transfer, but there is no bailing out, meaning rescue credit. The same goes for Switzerland and for Australia. While in the European Union, especially in the Eurozone, there is a formal non-bailout clause, meaning that other countries do not provide an insolvent country with money, but this was violated from the very beginning. So if there's one lesson, Eurozone should return to non-bailout clause, and countries should be responsible for their fiscal problems. Otherwise, there is no discipline and no responsibility. I know I have not finished this huge subject, but at least some points.
I actually have a general question about the central bankers, not only Fed, but also Bank of Japan and the ECB. Now, it seems that central bankers, with all the infusion of monetary policy, are absolutely confused about the low level of inflation, that they cannot create an economy. The Fed is constantly talking about it. What's your take on it? Why are they not able the level of monetization that they are doing be any substantial amount of inflation within the economy and monetize that government debt through that?
Well, this is again a very good question. Now, money consists of two parts. The one is called base money, it's the money created by the central bank. But by far largest part, it's a private money, which is created by the banks, commercial banks. Why? How do the banks create money? They lend, and they create an account on another side of the balance sheet, and this is money. Now, there has been a huge expansion, as you referred to, of the base money, which has not resulted in inflation because the private money has not grown. Why has private money or banks' money had not grown? Because there is not demand for credit. There's not a supply, not a lacking supply of credit by on the part of the banks, but there's not much demand. And people discuss why not, and usually they point out to uncertainty, that something blocks the willingness of private business to invest more and to demand more credit. And so where is this new created money spent? On buying the financial assets, which I mentioned, which drives the prices up, and on share buybacks. Because it's considered to be less risky than to invest in the expansion of the plants. So the basic question is, what creates such an uncertainty which prevents more investment and more growth? And there are people, I belong to them, which point out to policies which create uncertainty among the business, including the monetary policy, which is creates such a lot of money, and then there's a problem, how would it end? But also more regulates, excessive regulation, et cetera, et cetera.
Professor, it's a pleasure hearing you speak. I was just wondering, based on all of your mention of bubbles and whatnot, going off the previous questions concerning central banks, inflation, and bubbles in general, I was wondering if you thought that there is a bubble developing in the stock market based on the Federal Reserve's last 7 years or so of quantitative easing and artificial low interest rates, or if it's not there, is there a bubble somewhere?
Well, it's difficult to avoid the impression that prices of financial assets were driven to the level which is not sustainable. The question is how fast they would decline, and I think nobody knows for sure. Because I think markets are so dependent on what the central banks do. So this is de facto nationalization of financial markets in the sense of increased dependence on the action on the actions of the public actors. But there are some other side effects. Namely, if you keep very low interest rates, then investors are looking for better yield. So where they are looking for to more risky assets. And this includes lending to countries, corporations in countries like in Brazil, other emerging economies, which stimulated the bubbles, increased the public debt, and now we have a day of reckoning. If you look at Brazil, the public debt to GDP is over 70%, which is very high for Brazil. They would have to pay very high interest rates and are in recession. So, and they are politically paralyzed. So how do they go through that? One cannot avoid assumption that they are going to go bust and seek debt reduction. Like it happened. Because, you know, US monetary policy creates problems in other countries. These cycles of interest rates. So this was the case some 20 or 30 years ago in Latin America.
Professor Balcerowicz, there are many Polish people here, and I myself have family and friends in Poland. And this is a general question. What are your thoughts as far as your country, Poland, adopting the euro currency? If it will happen, and if it will happen, when do you think it will happen?
Well, it would not happen in the foreseeable future. And the sufficient reason for that is that it's very unpopular, because we have created a solid national currency in Poland called zloty. And people are watching too much TV and see these horror stories in Greece. So why should they change something which they know and like to something which is presented as being highly risky? Secondly, you would have to change our constitution. Because in the present constitution, it stands that Poland's national currency is zloty. To change the constitution, you would need 2/3 majority, which is not likely to appear in the foreseeable future. But this is not a tragedy, because there are more important things than monetary regime. You can be successful under any monetary regime if you have a certain fundamentals. Property rights, extended property rights, good protection of life and assets, of property, competition, reasonable administration, rule of law, moderate spending, and thanks to that, moderate taxation, opening the economy. So this is fundamentally important. So in Poland, we have to complete certain reforms so as to let Poland grow faster than the rich West, as was the case during the last 25 years, and in this way to bridge the gap between Poland and, say, Germany, France, Britain, etc. This is very important for poorer people, and it's also the only means to reduce emigration. Why people emigrate, usually? Sometimes they fall in love with some foreigners. I can see some cases here. But mostly because they want to have a better living. This was the case when Swedish people were emigrating to United States, to Minnesota, because Sweden was then very poor. Or Spanish people were emigrating to France some 40 years ago, and now it's occurring in certain Eastern Europe. And the only rational and effective response is to grow faster. So as people would prefer to stay at home. That's why reforms which strengthen economic growth are so crucially important. There is no more important national goal except for peace.
Just one other question that came to mind. Judging by what you've said so far, what do you think a government or politicians or the combination of both can do economically, if they can do anything at all to better a situation for their country? Or are you saying that, if at all possible, keep the government, keep the politicians out of the economic aspect of our lives, to a certain extent?
Well, they should good politicians, and politicians are good only when they are monitored by proper organizations, care, protect fundamentals of economic growth. Not only politicians, but public institutions like courts, justice system, which means that they try to protect property rights and are not too intrusive with regulation and foreign policies, of course. As long as we don't have one state, one government in the world, we need foreign policy. And as long as there are some unpleasant dictatorship, we need an army. And that's very important in this world.
One last question.
First question by my man.
Oh, yes. I don't know, how is it? In Poland, there are mostly women who ask questions.
So thank you, Professor, for a fascinating, for this somewhat challenging talk. You emphasized empirical data, facts, word fact, it's fact. And my question is more from a normative conceptual angle. You talked about human rights and you talked about freedoms, all sorts of freedoms, the top of which was economic freedom. You did just now in answer to the question, Matt, mention the word peace, but you didn't mention the word equality. And I'm wondering where you put equality, if it is a value, an idea, a concept, something that we do think of as important, at least in America, we think that equality is up there along with the freedoms. And in the past few years, at least, we have been seeing equality erased almost, economic equality, financial equality. The wealth that has come out of the recovery has gone to 1%, that proverbial 1% or whatever percent. Most of it has gone to something that is not called oligarchs, but definitely the rich or the wealthy. And I wonder if you think that if there is room for the politicians or for the state, or would it come out of the market itself to put equality up there just as important as, call it, economic freedom?
The problem with equality is that there's a lot of confusion. And one should start with distinction between equality of opportunity and equality or inequality of outcomes, situations, including wealth and income. Now, equality of opportunity means that people with similar characteristics have a similar chance to realize their professional plans. This does not mean that somebody who is very short has the same chance of being a prominent basketball player as somebody who is very tall. No, similar people. And this is a great idea. By the way, this is an ideal of classical liberalism. Before, there were feudal divisions. And it's something which is right to pursue. We most agree that the best inequality of opportunities is zero, meaning that one should strive to create situations where similar people have similar chances of implementing their professional plans. And we rightly try to abolish education inequalities for the same people, or inequalities in access to entrepreneurship, etc. And this is both just and effective for economic growth. What about inequality of income? Is the ideal zero too, meaning everybody would earn the same? Of course not. So you see that are completely different things, which are often confused. So and it's very emotionally discussed, using 1%, 10%. But do not confuse these two completely different issues. Now, people who highlight inequality of income disregard much more important problem, which is poverty. You may reduce inequality in such a way that poverty is increased, when you reduce opportunities for entrepreneurship. When you bash people only because they are rich, regardless of what they do. So do avoid this confusion. This is a second confusion. The first confusion is to not to distinguish between the problem of inequality of opportunity and inequality of income. The second one is to disregard the poverty. Now you have poverty, two kinds of poverty. First, countries which are poor. But why countries are poor? Because usually they have bad regimes, which is deprived of which are dictatorial, which are neo-socialist, and we have lots of. So you have to change that if you want to improve. And now, in a more advanced countries, of course you have margins of poor people, and there's a lot of discussion. Why? One of the reasons, like in the United States, and what I am saying is based on what I read, is poor public education. In many places, and if people got poor education, they cannot be very successful, especially when modern technology favors people with a specific education. So those who can collaborate with computers have a great chance. Those who can't are left behind. So instead of bashing the rich, one should look what produces the poverty, what blocks people with the advancement. And I think this is much, much more productive than just look to the inequalities. Finally, would you deprive Steve Jobs of 80% of his wealth when he was alive because he was just rich? What about Buffett? And if yes, why? Then here you one should distinguish with two types of rich people. Those who got rich because they were very good at innovations, calculation, and those who got rich because of political connections, like Sims, or Sim in Mexico, or these Russian oligarchs. So people who got rich because of political connections do not deserve it. People who got rich because they introduced something very useful, innovations, I think deserve much more. So again, you have to make the distinction. So without the distinction, you don't have a discussion. You have a nonsense, which is very popular. Why the book of Piketty was so popular? Because he was stimulating what? Envy, under the guise of science. And there are many regulations in developed countries which favor the rich. For example, if you have zoning, like in Britain, so you cannot, so rich people who have real estate are protected and you cannot build close to them. So they're rich, this is increasing, but this is very popular. So there are many bad policies which favor the rich in rich countries. And to start with, these policies should be eliminated. Is anything left as far as serious problems are concerned?
I think you've solved them all.
No, I am not.
I'd like to thank you, Professor Balcerowicz, and thank you all who took time tonight to join us. Welcome, please come back, and have a wonderful night. Thank you very much.